welcome back. Today I am going to be talking about the books that I read throughout September and October, minus the books that I read for the Climathon, because I've done a separate video talking about what books I read for the Climathon, so I'll link that down below. I'm just going to talk about the books that I've read outside of the Climathon. I'm also going to be participating in Nonfiction November, so I will be putting out a video in the next couple days about what books I want to read for that. I'm very excited because I love nonfiction books. Throughout September and October, I read 5 physical books and then 2 audiobooks, so I will talk about them now. So the first book that I finished is actually from the Climathon. I guess I'm a liar, but in that video, I was halfway finished the book, and then I did finish the book completely, and that is Braiding Sweetgrass by Robin Wall Kimmerer. Loved this book, absolutely loved this book. It is fantastic. She is a botanist and also an indigenous woman, and she kind of combines those two fields of knowledge in talking about humans' relationship to the planet and to each other and to nature and to plants and to mushrooms and to everything. And it's wonderful. Every single chapter kind of focuses on something different. She'll usually tell kind of like a story and then go more into facts and analyzing it. And it's so good. There were so many quotes in that book that I just absolutely adored. It is fantastic. It's something that I feel like I'm going to be referencing a lot and just going through. And I think if you have kind of a bit of despair for the planet, and maybe you're not looking for hope, but maybe you're looking for connection to something and like realizing how to connect better to something, I would pick up this book. Next up, we have 9 Perfect Strangers by Leanne Moriarty. I'm a big fan of Leanne Moriarty. I've read most of her books, I think, and I like them because they're kind of just like easy fiction, but with like a bit of depth, which I enjoy. It's almost like a beach read, but just not as fluffy, in my opinion. So 9 Perfect Strangers, there are 9 perfect strangers, and they all end up at this health retreat for different reasons. Some of them want to clean their bodies, some of them want to clean their minds, you know, all these different reasons that people go to kind of better themselves, if you will. And yeah, so they all meet there, and then it kind of becomes like a bit of a psychological thriller because the owner is kind of crazy, kind of loco. And yeah, so like stuff happens there. And I think it was a good book. It wasn't one of my favorites of hers. It may actually have been my least favorite book that I've read from Leanne Moriarty, but it was fun. It was good. She always tells the story from like the different perspectives of different people, which I enjoy because then you kind of get a fuller image of, I guess, how people feel about a situation. Ending kind of wrapped up too quickly. Not that it wrapped up neatly, like stuff happened and it was crazy, but it just kind of happened and then the story's over. I feel like I wish there was a bit more like exploration of that at the end, but good book. If you find it in like a train station, to me it's that kind of read where you just like read it on a train to pass the time. Okay, next book that I read is by Audre Lorde. The Master's Tools Will Never Dismantle the Master's House. First of all, can we talk about this edition? I had never seen these editions in real life. And then I did, and then I bought one, and I was really excited, and I kind of want to collect them all, but I have nowhere to put them. So it is a collection of five essays that she has written. Yes, 5 different essays that she has written. And it talks a lot about the intersectionalities that she faces as, let's see, Black, lesbian, mother, warrior, poet. And they're really good. It's nonfiction. I think it's one of those things that people should read, I guess. I want to reread this book actually and like engage with it a bit more in the sense of highlighting and kind of, I don't know, I feel like when I go through a book and I highlight and I underline and that kind of stuff, I really understand the content better. And with this book, I was so excited, first of all, to find her writing, and then secondly, because it's one of these editions that's just like so small and it just seems so easy to read. That I feel like I rushed through this book too quickly because I was like, ooh, cute little thing. And I mean, it's under 50 pages long, so it's a quick read, but I don't think it should be a quick read is what I'm trying to say. So highly recommend this. I will be rereading this hopefully this year, probably this year. It's 50 pages, but kind of going through it a little bit better to understand what she is saying a little bit better. Next up, I read When Hitler Stole Pink Rabbit by Judith Kerr. I had never heard of this book before. I found it in a hotel room or like a hotel book exchange. So I took it and it was okay. It's meant, I think, for a younger audience. It is also the first book in a trilogy, which I did not know. I will not be reading the rest of the trilogy though. So this is a fictional story told from like nonfiction events. So Judith Kerr lived through essentially what she talks about in this book. It happens during World War II. The main character, Anna, Anna and her family are Jewish and they're living in Germany. And her father is a prominent anti-Nazi writer in like different publications and journals and stuff, or in newspapers. And so essentially the Nazis want to get at him because he is against them. And so they have to flee Germany. They move around a little bit to like different countries and they end up in London. And it's an interesting book because it is told from the perspective of a child. This book though, I feel like she had quite a lot of privilege. Like the war affected her in the sense that her and her family had to move from their hometown, but they weren't like in direct contact with the war and with the fighting and the killing because they were able to escape it. So I think it's a good book in the sense that like if you have a younger person, like a preteen or like 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 year old, it's a good stepping stone into like exposure of what the war might have been like for some people. It was okay. I just don't think that I'm the target audience for this book. Last physical book that I read was fantastic. This is Before the Coffee Gets Cold, Tales from the Cafe by Toshikazu Kawaguchi. This is a sequel. I did not know this was a sequel. You can read it as a standalone as well. So essentially this is a story of a cafe where there's a bunch of rules, but generally you go and you sit in this one chair and then you are able to travel back into the future or back into the past for the duration of like when your coffee gets cold. So you get a hot cup of coffee, you time travel, and then you have to drink your coffee before it gets cold in order to return back into the present day. And it's a wonderful story. So it's a short little book, but it is divided into four parts, and each part is the story of a different person who has decided to time travel. And he does such a good job at being able to explain, I guess, like the emotions and the reasoning behind why somebody wants to time travel to try to see someone who they loved or they lost in such a short amount of time. Like there are four completely separate stories in here and I felt connected to all four of the stories. There is also woven within all of it the stories of the different workers from the cafe and how they got there, their relationships and their emotions and stuff. And it's so good. I really, really, really recommend this book. It was quick and easy to read. It was very impactful. Just a great book. Next up, I have two audiobooks that I listened to. First one was for the Stephen King Book Club, 11/22/63, which was like 30 hours, I think, on audiobook. And it was a long book. However, I really love this book. This is a book that I really had no interest in reading, but then it was picked for the book club, so I was like, okay, I'll read it. And I loved it. So it is the story of a man whose name I do not remember, I could not tell you. And this book also involves time travel. So Kennedy was assassinated and he has gone back into the past to essentially attempt to stop the assassination of Kennedy. And that, I don't know how to explain this because the elements of this book, I guess, are time travel, you know, trying to figure out what you can change in the past. And then also like when you do change the past, what happens in the future and how that affects everything and kind of like bending reality in a sense. But then the thing that I got the most out of this was the love story. So like in the past, he meets a woman and they fall in love and then it becomes, I don't want to give too much away, but it becomes this whole thing, right? Where he's from the present, but he's in the past and he has all these different connections from the past life, I guess. And which one does he value more and everything. And it was really good, honestly. The love story was incredible. And I didn't actually expect that because first of all, it's Stephen King, who doesn't write women well. I don't think he wrote the main character, like the main woman in this book, well either. She was a little bit like feeble in a sense, but also she was well from the past. So I guess like generational difference and stuff. But I didn't love how he wrote the woman. However, I loved the love story. It was so unexpected. I thought this was gonna just be a book about time travel, but it ended up being much more than that. And I do recommend it. If you have 30 hours of your life to give to Stephen King, I would recommend this book. And the last book that I read was inspired by Maza, the booktuber. He was doing a read along for this book and I was like, yes, it's October, creepy stuff, let's do it. I read Tender as the Flesh by, I have my notes here. Tender as the Flesh by Agustina Bastarrica. This is it is a dystopian world where we no longer slaughter animals for meat. We now slaughter humans for meat, but we obviously don't call them humans because we always need that cognitive dissonance, right? Just like how we don't call beef cow. You need a bit of a divide from what you're actually doing. And so this story is told from the perspective of a slaughterhouse worker and what he does in his everyday life, the struggles that he faces mentally in like what he is doing as well. It uses kind of a lot of, I guess, like graphic language. However, it didn't like freak me out as much as I thought it would. I think because like I haven't eaten meat in many, many years. And part of that is because of like researching slaughterhouses. And so like a lot of the terminology that was used in this book is just like the basic terminology that people use for slaughtering other animals. And so like, while I get that it's humans, I think because like, I'm obviously opposed to killing humans for meat, but I'm also opposed to like killing other animals for meat. And so it like wasn't as freaky to me because I'm like, well, yeah, this does happen. It just happens to like other animals that we like put on a different value scale, I guess, as a society. So it was a good book though. I would recommend it. It was well written. And you could like, you could tell, I guess, the struggle that the slaughterhouse worker was facing in kind of what he had to do for work versus like how society was now viewing eating meat, so which was humans, right? So anyways, on that fun note, these are all the books that I read in September/October. Like I said, I am going to be doing nonfiction November because I like to read nonfiction anyway, and I just heard about that readathon from Jess Owens, and so I will be filming my own video on what I want to read very, very shortly. I think I might also do a standalone book review on this book because I really enjoyed it, and I kind of want to start doing more videos that are like standalone book reviews. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you in the next video. Bye.